Okay, welcome back. Now we are going to go treat all the theories that we have reviewed, from Gaussian noise to elliptical functions to Jacobian matrices and Kalman filtering, apply to our most difficult problem of manipulated robot, rather mobile robot, and that's localization. So back to my station here. The simplest and crudest way of estimating the location of the mobile robot is dead reckoning. What's dead reckoning? Dead reckoning is the estimation of a robot's location based on its estimated speed, direction, and time of travel with respect to previous estimate. So you are located in location A, you want to go to location B, you use the estimated speed and direction that you had at A, and the amount of time that the robot travels between A and B, try to see where am I actually, am I at B or I'm somewhere different than where I hope to be. So back in chapter 4, you may recall there was a third order nonlinear dynamic model for a mobile robot, which has sine and cosine of theta. And it was a simple model, but still it depends on the inputs of the system. And a lot of times you don't have the luxury of the amount of input into the model, named the control signal. So instead of using that equation, here you have a discrete time model for the evolution of configuration based on odometry, where delta k is delta d comma delta theta is the distance traveled from A to B, and change in the heading over the preceding value. Delta theta is the change in the heading of the manipulator, where it was at A and where it's going to end up at B. And k is the time step. So this is a typical, you may recall, a 3x3 transformation matrix of the robot. Here's the rotation part, here's the translation part. Okay. And if you go through transformation, we choose to move forward in the x direction by delta d, and then rotate it by delta theta, giving the new configuration, which is here. This is the transformation matrix of the rotation part. This is the translation, and this is the original one. So you multiply all three together to get to it. In other words, going from A to B, you have a change in the position and orientation. Those are two different transformations. And you multiply them, post-multiply them. This is due to the distance traveled, this is to change in the orientation. So you end up with this equation, which we can write it in this form. It's going to be x of k plus delta k times cosine of theta plus delta theta, and similarly for y, and your orientation is going to have a change of delta theta. This is estimated pose of the robot at point B. Okay, but the problem is the odometry error. The noises are there. So in order to make up for the odometry error, delta T is going to add an uncertain component, a noise attached to it, and delta theta is another value right here. So now equation 6.2, which also is here, is now a mathematical formulation for the position of the robot at point, the next step, point B, in spite of incorporating the noises and inaccuracies on orientation and the distance. Again, the whole thing is represented as a zero mean Gaussian process whose variance is this, and it's assumed that the distance traveled from point A to B and the change orientation, they're not correlated with each other. That's why you have zero and zero in the non-diagonal elements. Okay. So you go through this, and this is the way you run the toolbox for dead reckoning. And what we now want to do is to actually use Kalman filtering to estimate the pose, being represented by this equation right here. We want to keep going from point A to B to C to D and so forth as we move along in the time horizon. We want to each step, we want to use Kalman filtering to estimate it. You can see equation 6.2 is obviously nonlinear. So you have to linearize it to use extended Kalman filter. So here is the linearized version of that equation. Again, you have a couple of Jacobian matrices, f of x and f of v. Okay, f of v is associated with the noise, f of x with x. And you use the old location plus this addition to come up with a new location. The Jacobians are obtained by differentiating that equation with respect to x evaluated at v equal to 0. Then, of course, as I told you last time, here is a brief biography of Professor Kalman. Okay? And f is partial of f respect to v, which is shown here. That's one, the other, the second Jacobian matrix. And that's how you calculate it, based on the value of the sigma x, sigma d, and sigma theta. We now can write extended Kalman filter prediction equation. Here is the prediction of the covariance matrix from appendix H that we just looked at. And then, of course, the next estimation is going to use the same old nonlinear function of the pose equation. And then here you actually define your initial value of the covariance matrix, diagonal of 0.005, 0.05, and 0.001 all squared. Okay, this is sigma 1 squared, sigma 2 squared, sigma 3 squared, the three standards of deviation. For x location of the d, y location, component, and theta. EKF is the command for extended Kalman filter, and then you run it for 1,000 times right here. Okay. Then the author wants to remind you again about the ellipse, the location of the two axes of the ellipse, which shows x in one direction, y in another direction. That portion is going to be the uncertainty in the y direction, and that portion uncertainty in the x direction. So you can plot all of those and get this equation. This equation shows you, basically, here you have an environment or a map of minus 15 to plus 15 and minus 15 to plus 15 on the y direction. The robot is initially at this location right here. And it's going like this. It's traversing like this, going here and then here, here, and go on and on like this, and eventually ending at 0, 0 at the origin. So what you see here is that the graph is being held in MATLAB, and then you compute all the elliptical functions. Right here, this command. EKF.plot _ellipse of function, and it's all in GG is for green, color of green. So let me traverse this one more time and describe what's going on. Watch my magic hand. I'm coming here and I have in the center of the ellipse right here. Okay. You have this value, correction, uncertainty in one direction, another value in this direction. And as you see, the size of the ellipse is big, which means you have quite a bit of error. As I move with that hand here, I get to the center of this ellipse. Things get even worse. Things get even worse. Okay, at least in this direction. Then I move and I move to here. This is another ellipse right here. And here, and here, and here for this ellipse, and this ellipse, this ellipse, and so forth and so on. And by the time you get what, the ellipse gets smaller and smaller, and you get more certain and certain, more and more certain to reach the right place. So, in this case, every iteration of the extended Kalman filter has one ellipse, one Gaussian function. It shows uncertainty due to odometry of the location of the ellipse. But if you print and plot superimposed on the trajectory, a finite number of those steps, you see all those ellipses. Now notice that the blue is the true path of the robot and the red is the one which estimated from odometry in red. Okay? Which is pretty good. They're right next to each other. Okay? Now here is your at step number 700, this is your covariance matrix right here. If I take a square root of 0.4674, I get sigma. If I multiply by 2, it's becoming plus or minus 1.37. This means that there is a 95% chance that the robot x coordinate is within plus or minus 1.37 meters. That's for this. So now let's look at this magic hand at the 2-2 location. This is the covariance, the standard deviation of y direction. And if I take a square root of 2, that 0.7394, and multiply by 2, I get 1.72 instead of 1.37. So as we can see, in the y direction is much worse than x direction. Now come to 3-3 element, 0.0267. Take a square root of that, multiply by 2. The answer should be 0.32, which is not in the text, but I calculated it myself. 0.32, which is very, very small number compared to 1.37 and 1.72. So going from at step 700, the error in the orientation is much less than x, and that's less than y. So those diagonal values of the covariance matrix at any given instant time tell you how far you are from reality, from the correct value. Okay. All right, now let's now use a map, which is what I understand, you know, you are going to be doing experiment number 3. Broad has been started yet?
Today.
Okay. We set up a section of the A star as a quote and code your map. You can do the same thing in your robotic simulation. There's a command called map that you could use. In this case, this map is going to give you 20 landmarks fixed values, fixed location, and plus or minus 10 meters. So you are looking at this kind of, let me see, where am I? Okay. 20 is those number of, squares or near squares here. If you count these ones, you got 20 of those. Plus 10 here, minus 10 here. Minus 10 here, and plus 10 here. So by this command, map, you put this thing together with all those fixed landmarks. Those landmarks are going to be very useful for you to do mid-course correction for the location of the robot. It's just like a large boat is moving in the ocean close to the coast and keep using at the light towers and using the fixed location of the light tower where I am and how much mistake it is in my location. Okay. So in this case, the sensor, which is typically like a scanning laser range finder like this, which I believe we may have it on those commercial robots in the lab. And the mathematical description of this sensor is going to be a nonlinear function of x, v, which is the vehicle state, xf, which is the location of the observed feature. Observed feature are those squares that you saw in the map, and w, which is the random variable that models error in the sensor. So you have three variables in the 6.8. Then if you calculate the, if you put the entire dynamic model of the robot in terms of polar coordinate, an angle beta and a radius of r and a distance of r, you can go from Cartesian coordinates to polar coordinates. You've seen that in your control background, like a phasor. Okay? Like a phasor. Okay? If you recall, your design could be on a Cartesian coordinate like a root locus, or you can design it on a polar coordinate like a Nyquist plot. Remember those? The same concept. So if we go to a polar plot here, you got r, which is the square root of the difference of the two locations from yi minus yv, xi minus xv, and then the two components of the noise due to r and beta, and the r conjunct of the ratio of these two minus the correction, minus the error. So here z is now represented by a vector r and beta. R is the range, beta is the bearing angle, and the measurement noise is given by this, which again is a Gaussian with mean value of zero and a covariance of w, which is this diagonal matrix. And you can go through that process using range bearing sensor command, all of that, and then you come up with the value of z. So what you want to do next is to look at the difference between where you are estimating and where you are actually are. That is similar to the v you saw in previous section, as well as in appendix H, Kalman filtering. Okay, and then this is going to be the difference. And then, so as we did previously, we linearize the observation. So we linearize the observation or the sensor value, again, with a couple of Jacobian matrices, H of X and H of W, defined by this equation. And by this equation, for omega w equal to zero at that nominal value, then you end up to be a Kalman gain update, equation 16, and then you have the innovation equation, and you have the covariance matrix update, and the state itself. So these four are application of extended Kalman filter for a pose of the robot. And you can run that through this, and what you see is actually going through the same contour as you saw before. Each time you, when you get near, you make take advantage of information you have, fixed location of this landmark and this landmark. You come here, you take advantage of this landmark, and then here you get landmark here. You keeping yourself within the vicinity of those landmarks without running into them, okay? You want to avoid those landmarks because those are fixtures in your mind. So, extended Kalman filter localization showing the true path of the robot, which is the blue, and the estimated one from odometry and landmarks in red. The robot starts at the origin. Okay, so it's just the opposite of what I told you. It starts at the origin, goes the other way around. So it goes like this. Okay. So, this diagram showed a close-up of the robot through an estimated path. True one is the blue one, and the red one is the estimated path. Okay. And you can see that you go very close to a landmark here. You have somewhat away from it. And then this diagram shows the covariance magnitude as a function of time. So this is the covariance function as a function of time. Determinant of the covariance, square root of the determinant of the P matrix, the covariance matrix, as a function of time. Which, as you can see, is quite random and unpredictable situation. Okay, so now let's look at a situation where you want to actually creating a map. Okay, so far we have taken the existence of the map for granted. We have been given a map for you. An understandable mindset, given that maps today are common and available for free via internet. Nevertheless, somebody or something has to create maps. Our next example considers the problem of robot moving in an environment with landmarks and creating a map of their location. So as you move along from your origin to destination, as you move along, you make up your own, you make up the look map, you create the map. Okay. And as before, we have a range and bearing sensor mounted on the robot, which measures imperfectly the position of feature with respect to the robot. So again, suppose you have M landmarks. This is the location of M landmarks, X and Y location of the first one. Remember those small squares? This is the coordinate of the first one, second one. In that case, for that map, M was equal to 20. Remember, 20 of those. So here's for M. We have two M elements which we have to estimate. Okay, as again, in Kalman filter. The corresponding estimate covariance P hat will be 2m by 2m matrix. the state vector has a variability since we do not know in advance how many landmarks exist. In other words, we don't know how far we're going to go from landmark one to landmark number two. We don't know the location yet. If you don't know the location, you don't know how far to go. Okay. So the prediction equation is straightforward. This, since the feature do not move. So the thing which is relevant here is that you want to estimate location of the robot with respect to those fixed landmarks. Landmarks one, number one we know in this x1, y1, in x2, y2, x3, y3. And those are the values that has to be estimated. Okay. So we introduce the function g, which is the inverse of h. Remember what was h? H was the nonlinear equation of the measurement of the sensor. This is just the opposite. And gives the coordinates of the observed feature based on the known vehicle pose and sensor observation. In other words, you are, let's say, in moving from here to here and so forth. You know where you start, you have 0, 0. You know where this location is, x1, y1. Okay. And through the, since you know where you are, if you invert it, you get information about how to get to that point. This is the objective of this g function. Okay. G is the inverse of h. No, it's just like inverse kinematics. You know where you are, you like to end up, but how to get there, you get it by the inverse function. Okay. And that is g, which is h to the power of minus 1. And that is described by this equation. So, since x hat has a variable length, we need to extend the state vector and the covariance matrix whenever we encounter a landmark. So what happens here that as you encounter landmark number one, your distance x and your orientation of the robot is going to be different. It keeps changing because you are encountering new landmarks. So the state vector is extended by the function y, which is a nonlinear function, and the covariance matrix is going to be for the extended when a new landmark is observed. So each time you get a new landmark, you have to calculate the linearized version of the equation of the inverse g matrix, g vector function, and then you eventually reach the final value. And these are the values of the diagonal part of the covariance matrix. You only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Your count limit is 20. You have 20 of those values. This is happening within vicinity of landmark number 1, number 2, number 3, and so on. So as you move along, you keep estimating the location of the landmark. Okay. I know I rushed it through, but I hope that you will read that chapter and have your robot toolbox next to you, and you can work on it like that. Now, the final approach is localization and mapping. Finally, we tackle the problem of determining our position and creating a map at the same time. That's why we say simultaneous. This is an old problem in marine navigation and cartography. Incrementally extending a map, which also using the map for navigation. In robotics, this problem is known as simultaneous localization and mapping, SLAM, S-L-A-M. So SLAM is a very important problem of mobile robotics. And this is what my students in the lab have done by using image processing. For example, when Dr. Benavides Patrick was a student, worked with another Indian student of mine, Mohan Mopidi, they used image processing to do SLAM, and they call it V-SLAM, visual SLAM. So this is not visual SLAM. So far in this book, we haven't talked about image processing. Those are future chapters, okay? But this is the regular SLAM. And sometimes it's called concurrent mapping and localization, CMM. So a state vector comprises a vehicle configuration and coordinate of the M landmarks together. So you see, you have the location of the vehicle, X and Y location, the orientation of it, or heading angle, and location of the first landmark, second landmark, and M landmark. So you have lots of variables. If you have 20 variables here, 20 times 2 is 40, X's and Y's, and then you have 3 more here. At any instant time, you have 43 variables to estimate. Okay. It's 2M plus 3 element, this is what I was saying. Covariance is going to be 2M plus 3 by 2M plus 3 matrix, shown here. Again, you have that inverse function G. You go through Jacobian matrices, and this is how you do it for SLAM. Okay. Again, extended Kalman filtering is used. Okay. And then this will be simultaneous localization and mapping. Okay. And look carefully. Let me increase this a little bit. Look carefully at this diagram. You see those green stuff? What are they? They are the ellipses. It used to be big one for depth reckoning and was very inaccurate situation at the beginning of the discussion. Now you see the size of these ellipses, so small. That means you are doing very good job of estimating all the way through. Okay? So this is the result of simultaneous localization and mapping, showing the true blue values and estimated the red values, and superimposed on the true is the black features, landmarks, indicated by the plus or minus marks, and the 5 sigma confidence ellipses, which are green, these ellipses, okay? So, you are estimating that this particular landmark is at this location, but it's actual a little bit farther away. But it's pretty good estimate, as you can see. So, in this diagram, figure 6.11, simultaneous localization mapping. A is the covariance versus time. That's the determinant, the square root of the determinant of the covariance matrix versus time. And B is the final covariance matrix. Values have been scaled in the interval 0 to 255. So this is the covariance matrix, which is very difficult to judge it. You just show it in this fashion, depending on the values that you have here, okay. Now, this is the end of chapter 6, more or less. There is also Monte Carlo localization, which we are not going to cover, you know, but as I said, you take a look at these, exercises. Exercise number 4 is dead reckoning. Exercise number 5 is using a map, which is a fixed Excel number 6, making a map. Excel 7 is another localization and mapping. What I may do is to actually give you one must-do problem and give you a choice of choosing the one of the other three. But when you get it submitted, I'll make sure the partners are not using the same choice. Okay, you have partners have to use different choices. Okay, and then sooner than later you're gonna come to in my place and talk to the class. Your project and your homework like this are gonna be subject of your discussion and your presentation, which you tell your buddies in the class how much you learn and how what issues you confronted and so forth and so on. Okay. So this is a very, very challenging course. I've never been challenged more than this semester for this course because we are covering a ton of things. You know. And when the final is over, go visit your resume and update it. Put all the right issues in it. It comes in handy later. You talking about manipulated robotics, kinematic dynamics, etc. Inverse kinematics, talk about mobile robotics, kinematics of those, dynamics of those. You talk about navigation, localization, carbon filtering, cloud, you know, all those experiments. And I wish I was 50 years younger, 45 years younger. I would be in your location, okay? But it didn't turn out to be that way because when I was that age, I didn't even know what's the meaning of ROBOT, the robot. And then the robot was not a big an issue anymore. But this is what happens to you. When you graduate, this is the beginning of your learning, not the end of it. You're gonna be stretched in an industry or in other academia or whatever, and they're gonna give you things that you have never seen before. And your boss doesn't care if you haven't seen it before. He said, go and do it. In a month, I want you to see how much you have done. Okay. That's how it is. And I've done it myself, 4 years in industry. So, good luck, we'll see you next time.